Hi. Norbick, 1870 to 1936. Well driller, statesman, first native governor of South Dakota, U.S. Senator, founder of Custer State Park, sponsor of Mount Rushmore, memorial road builder, art lover, poet of nature, patriot, gentleman. Wow, he done it all. Hiss was the heritage of cold, strong lands. Hiss, the pioneer vision which saw far ahead, far beyond. He felt the strong heart throb of his beloved people, commanding him to do greatly and be great. In these mountains, he found a wilderness for them and labored to preserve its beauty unspoiled for them and for their children's children. He is still present in every mile of road that he built in the noble pines and towering rocks he loved, and in the hearts of the multitudes who will enjoy them. That's awesome. And when you turn around, look what you see. I'm still on Iron Mountain Road. It just split off to single lane. Kind of neat. At least you don't have to worry about someone coming on your side. Oop, there's a little, oh, his buddy got run over. One of those little chipmunks. Anyway, I don't know if I finished saying what I was saying, but you don't have to worry about cars coming over and hitting you on these curves from the other side, or motorcycles that are trying to go too fast. Well, that didn't last very long. That's interesting. I wonder why they done that. Oh well, that was kind of neat. Man, this guy that did all this is amazing. I never heard of him. He must have been a very, very busy man. We're looking for rocks. Oh, look at the shiny rock. I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but these rocks are glittering. Narrow tunnel coming up. Gotta make sure nobody's coming through it. Ooh, I got lucky. thought he was going to come in there with me. I don't know if we would have both fit. That's neat. Oh, there goes a little chipmunk again. You better stop the road, buddy. Okay, we're going to split off again. Neat. Well, this state's got a lot going on. Do about everything here. They got side-by-sides running everywhere up and down the roads. They got trails for that. Horses, trails for that. Hiking trails. There goes another one. Lakes to fish and swim and kayak. And I don't know what else. I guess in the wintertime it's snow skiing and snowboarding. Another tunnel. Make you dizzy. There it is. Mount Rushmore. Amazing talent right there. Gotta stop and get a picture of my bike with that. $5 lemonade. It helps support the park, so that's all right. I could make a whole gallon for $5 probably. There it is.
Said, a preposterous idea, an outrage against South Dakota's Black Hills. What arrogant American stone carver could possibly improve upon God's mountain sculpture. But as the faces of the great man sprang lifelike from the mountain, Rushmore simply overwhelmed its critics and dazzled the world, just as the Republican ideals it honored had inspired and dazzled mankind in 1776. The project was conceived by a gentle scholar, Doane Robinson, in 1923, at a time when the nation was prosperous and cocky. Robinson proposed that several granite spires in the Black Hills be carved into massive human figures. Lewis and Clark, Buffalo Bill Cody, Chief Red Cloud, or other Western heroes. To the sculptor he called upon for help, Gutzon Borglum, this idea seemed as bold and brilliant and as fragile as a rainbow in the western sky. The son of Danish immigrants, Borglum was a man who dreamed big and talked big, a man ideally suited to the times and to the carving of mountains. American art ought to be monumental, he said, in keeping with American life, and Rushmore ought to be colossal in keeping with American achievements. Borglum found the needles impressive but too weathered for sculpting. Mount Rushmore, however, seemed perfect. Stone with a finer grain and texture, a mountain big enough for Borglum's imagination. Borglum argued that a monument on this scale should represent our entire national experience. His final concept would be a tribute to the founding, preservation, growth, and development of the nation. These events would be symbolized by the images of four Americans who never lost sight of the simple idea that man has a right to be free and to be happy. Washington, Jefferson, Theodore Roosevelt, Abraham Lincoln. Jefferson had articulated the central idea of the American democracy. We hold these truths to be self-evident, he wrote in the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. More than 20 years later, when Jefferson became president, the red-haired Virginian also proved to be a great nation builder. His purchase of the Louisiana Territory in 1803 opened the way to America's westward expansion. George Washington was the father of his country. In the darkest hours of the Revolution, his courage and resolve seemed never to falter. By sheer force of character, he brought the nation victory in its war of independence. There were some who wanted to crown him emperor, but Washington would have none of it, choosing instead to nurture, in his own words, the sacred fire of liberty. As our first president, Washington set about to make the lofty ideals of the Declaration of Independence work in practice. For his iron rectitude, for his inspired vision of the future of a free people, and the dignity he brought to the office of the presidency, Washington will be remembered for as long as men dream of freedom. The great emancipator, Abraham Lincoln, guided the destiny of the nation during its greatest trial, the war between the states. Let us have faith, he said, that right makes might. And in that faith, let us to the end dare to do our duty as we understand it. Lincoln was the prophet of America's permanence and of liberty, tolerance, and social justice for all our people. To political freedom, Theodore Roosevelt extended economic freedom. He was the daring trust buster, passionate conservationist, and friend of the common man. At a time when the U.S. was emerging as a world power, he led the march toward new frontiers, forging new links between East and West with the Panama Canal. We here in America hold in our hands the hopes of the world, he wrote. And shame and disgrace will be ours if in our eyes the light of high resolve is dimmed, if we trail in the dust the golden hopes of men. The mountain was dedicated August 10, 1927. The symbol of the moment was a set of drill bits handed to Borglum by President Calvin Coolidge. With his customary showmanship, the sculptor put them right to work on the face of the mountain. For guidance in his design of studio models of the presidents, Borglum studied photographs, portraits, and life masks using the sculptor's tools of light and shadow to create likenesses with human character and vitality.
Generation.
1941, as a final dedication was being planned, Guts and Borglum died, leaving his son Lincoln to close down the work. When he first arrived in the Black Hills, Borglum was 57. Until his death 17 years later, Rushmore had been the focus of his life, his all but impossible dream. In both its conception and realization, Rushmore is uniquely American, proclaiming bold ideals and big aspirations, celebrating the spirit of our people and the sweep of our civilization, reminding us of the hope a democratic society offers for the future. It is a monument no less to the men who, working together, transformed a lofty dream into a colossal reality, a work of art for the ages. A monument's dimensions shall be determined by the importance to civilization of the events commemorated, Borglum had said when he began. Let us place there, carved high, as close to heaven as we can, our leaders, their faces, to show posterity what manner of men they were. Then breathe a prayer that these records will endure until the wind and rain alone